So I'm very happy to be in Bedlewo for the third time already, and very grateful and to the organizers for this nice opportunity to give a talk for you. So here I am representing not just myself, but our new research institute called Materials Innovation Factory within the University of Liverpool. As you can guess, well, it was funded by the Liverpool Trust, which is a well-known charitable organization in the UK, but also by a maybe less known commercial company whose logo is displayed here, and I am wondering if you recognize this logo. So what's the company?
Unilever,
indeed. So before I moved to Liverpool, I actually knew very little about this company. However, it has more than 50 billion euros annual turnover, and actually occupies one floor in our materials innovation factory. So it's indeed a very close collaboration with industry. Well, the talk will be not about pure mathematical theorems, but about inspiring applications. So we'll try to make connections with our research in this direction, and would like to encourage especially younger people to come and apply topological data analysis for real life applications. So as Gunnar did excellently in the morning, let me mention a few other really applied topics before moving to material science. So the best known application for computer vision in TDA is the following client bottle model. I mentioned only the last paper by Gunnar and Jose Pere on this topic. So they have studied a point cloud that came from natural images, grayscale images, by considering small patches, 3x3 patches in grayscale images, and they could be mapped to, after some normalization and shifts, they could be mapped to a large point cloud in a seven-dimensional sphere. So now we have a big point cloud in a seven-dimensional sphere, and as turned out, most densest points in this cloud are distributed near the client bottle. And this can be very naturally explained. So here you see a table of this grayscale 3x3 patches, and they are arranged very naturally on the square, and if you glue the sides of the square as usual doing topology, then the result is a client bottle. So it means that for every grayscale patch in a natural image, we could find a corresponding point on an interesting client bottle sitting in a seven-dimensional sphere. So then another application, so my own studies in computer vision in collaboration with Microsoft were about finding structure in noisy point clouds. So here you see a classical barcode on a product in a shop, but I guess you cannot read it. So what product is hidden behind this barcode? So this is show barcode, and we will produce different ones, topological barcodes. So why? Because such visual markers, so this is an example of an Egyptian hieroglyph, they were recognized many thousand years ago in ancient Egypt, and the idea is to use more user-friendly barcodes. So instead of this digital barcodes, we could use more user-friendly barcodes based on visual markers like that. So people could, at least in ancient Egypt, easily recognize the meaning of the symbol. And at least now we could recognize the shape of this graph. And if we scan this image, then we could see, this is a noisy sample of an Egyptian hieroglyph. And if you analyze the one-dimensional persistence diagram, and consider only the most persistent features above the widest diagonal gap, then we could output an approximate skeleton for the original point cloud. And this procedure takes as an input only the point cloud without asking for any extra input parameters. So since humans could recognize the shape, the skeleton hidden behind this cloud, then computers should be able to do the same. And indeed, well, we have demonstrated it in this simple application. Also, I would like to mention a very different direction well taken by my PhD student Grzegorz Muzynski, who has recently started his PhD funded by Intel. So this is an application of topological methods to climate science. And the first topic of his PhD is to detect extreme weather events such as atmospheric rivers. So in these two pictures we see a scalar field, so a scalar function whose values are the so-called integrated water vapor. So it reflects how much water we have well in our atmosphere above well a point above a small square on the planet. So you see, well, this well long filament actually looks like a river in the atmosphere, and indeed an atmospheric river well has its name because the amount of water can be more than in the Amazon River. So, and when this atmospheric river well flows down from the sky to California, then we have floods. So this is well we could have serious economic damage, so that's why it's important to distinguish well atmospheric rivers from similar events that do not cause floods well in this situation. Well, despite we might have higher values of integrated water vapor somewhere, but we don't have well a long narrow filament that might cause an actual flood. Okay, now moving to material science, let me start again from motivations. So one of the dreams of material scientists, at least at Liverpool, is to build new molecular structures that can capture well, dangerous gases. So they should have well, enough pores or voids well, to attract gas molecules and then keep them inside. So this is for methane storage, carbon dioxide capture, and well, the next question: how could we achieve that? And here I gave well a very brief answer to this question, and this is actually the title of a famous talk by a famous person. I am wondering if you could guess who gave this first answer before. So it was about 60 years ago. There was a talk by a very famous physicist entitled...
Must be Feynman.
Feynman, absolutely. Like Feynman. Yes, thank you, Jacek. So Richard Feynman indeed gave a talk about 60 years ago, well, claiming that there is plenty of room at the bottom. And, well, in more details, let me show this bottom where you have plenty of room. So, when we have molecules, there is actually a lot of molecules with atoms, there is a lot of space between them. So, plenty of room. So, let me describe one of well, popular structures called a metal organic framework. So, it is a collection of molecules well, containing carbon, so that's why they are organic, well, and metal atoms, so all together. So, organic chemistry is about well, molecules containing carbon. So chemical bonds within a single molecule, well, represented here well, by natural edges, they are strong, they are called covalent bonds. However, there are also bonds between molecules, and they are called non-covalent, they are weaker. However, if we have, well, sufficiently many such weaker bonds, well, we have a solid material as a result. So all molecules can be held together. Well, if you look at this structure, I'm wondering if you could recognize what it is. Any ideas? Well, let me give you a hint that red balls in chemistry usually represent oxygen. Yes, well, both answers are correct. Well, water, yes, water molecules, absolutely right, H2O. But this particular structure is called a hexagonal ice. So it is a solid material, and you might recognize well, hexagonal cycles here and molecules well hold together due to hydrogen bonds between different molecules. Okay, so after, well, so how does it work? So in theory, well, there are several obstacles. The theoretical obstacles to a design of new materials is the following. We could choose, well, some small basic molecules, but they conform to many different, substantially different combinatorial geometric combinations to form a solid material. Simply too many of them, and it's hard to predict which are good and which are not. So this is the theoretical difficulty. Well, in practice, well, we have some, well, metal nodes, some, well, linker materials, linker nodes, and then, well, as the output we get, well, a structure looking like what? You see huge, well, tubes or, well, pores of, well, very small size. It's about less than 1 nanometer, 10 to the power minus 9. Well, however, well, we are interested to build, well, stable materials like that. So this was just the theoretical difficulty. The practical difficulty is even, well, is even harder. Because imagine we have, well, even manually, we have constructed, well, such a structure. But then we need to physically synthesize it in a lab. And it turns out, well, I didn't know when I was a pure mathematician, but chemists have explained me many times, but this is a time-consuming process, simply trying to synthesize, so it might not be possible at all. So that's why it's important that we focus only on most promising candidates. So we should not, well, try to synthesize everything we predict, but only top-performing candidates. Well, so what data can we use from material scientists? So the input actually can be very similar to the general input suitable for topological data analysis. So in topological data analysis, our input is a point cloud or finite metric space, and indeed many material structures can be considered as a point cloud. So this is a cloud of two-dimensional colloidal particles. Well, this is a point sample from a zeolite framework, actually from the paper by Catherine and Pavel, so I'll mention more details later. So this is a point sample of inner three-dimensional space. And this is an example of a crystal structure from a recent paper in Nature. And this structure, well, geometrically can be considered as a graph in a three-dimensional space. However, we could also, well, attach many, well, features describing local geometry of molecules and also chemical properties. So we could associate a feature vector to this crystal structure, and then one crystal structure will generate one point in our point cloud, and the whole molecular data set will correspond to a big point cloud in high dimensional configuration space. So these are examples of our data, and the output, well, it's a bit different from the standard output of topological data analysis. We would like to see, well, chemists, our colleagues, would like to get automatic tools for predicting. So which materials, say in a simple case, are similar to well-known materials already. So how to generate materials similar to, well, this one. Or absolutely new materials, but what have interesting properties like superconductivity. Okay, so you see the output should be much more practical. So it's not just a barcode, not a resistance diagram, but going further. So the idea is to bridge this gap and work very closely with material scientists. So how do they work, well, so far? So far, the most common method to generate hypothetical materials is by Monte Carlo simulations. So they start from some initial configuration of, well, basic molecules, and then try to perturb atoms in a given configuration, evaluate the so-called lattice energy, and optimize, and to optimize it to get a more stable structure with a lower energy. So it is a long process. So this is a slow algorithm with Monte Carlo simulation, and finally it outputs, well, say a data set of many potential structures, and many of them actually could be almost duplicate structures, because this is an optimization process. It, well, never guarantees that we get even to a local minimum, so we could be, well, close enough, and we could get many, well, structures close to the same local minimum according to this lattice energy. So that's why having this, well, large data set, well, chemists currently actually struggle to identify which structures are geometrically similar or not. And they use their own approach. They use chemical properties, no geometry, no topology at all. So they again run our simulations, predicting chemical properties such as, well, powder diffraction patterns for a given hypothetical structure. And they and after that they compare structures by looking at these, well, say, powder diffraction patterns, because this is a simpler output. So powder diffraction pattern looks like just a one variable function over angles, and while they look well peaks of two different functions are similar or not. So sometimes, well, hard to do it well by eye, then they apply PCA, so they convert this one variable function into a vector. So we get now a point in high dimensional space. So for the whole data set, it's a cloud in high dimensional space. They apply PCA or clustering, but this is just, well, just the beginning. So we could offer much, well, much more sophisticated and suitable tools for them. Well, let me illustrate this approach by, well, already established results. So by Catherine and Pavel, about zeolites. So zeolites they are natural materials. So they are, so zeolite in Greek means a boiling stone. So why boiling? Because if we heat this material, then we can see a lot of steam going out. So it contains a lot of water inside, surprisingly. And when we heat, it's boiling. It's boiling literally. So it absorbs a lot of water. We have about 40 types in the nature, and one of them, this one, natrolite, actually can be found in Poland. And at a nanoscale, this structure looks like that, and now you see these pores that could contain water molecules inside. So these are, that's why these are good candidates for capturing not only water, but gas molecules as well. So chemists now try to synthesize new zeolites. So not found in nature, but new better zeolites for capturing say methane and other gases. So hypothetical zeolites are combinatorial models, so they are virtual. We could generate millions of them. So this is one of the examples, according to, again, typical computer simulations. And after that, after we have such a set, data set of, for example, 140,000 zeolites in this paper, then we have a huge haystack, and we need to find a suitable needle in that haystack. We need to find the top performing material that would absorb methane and be actually stable in practice. So low energy and large enough capacity for methane storage. So let me show the main numerical results. So I think they have been already updated. So this is the paper by Bernd Schmidt, Catherine Hess and Pavel Lotkin. The reference to the archive was on the previous slide, but it has now been accepted in Nature Communications this year. So the aim was to discover high-performance materials based on hypothetical zeolites, and the numerical result is the following. So if we try to analyze hypothetical zeolites by using topological persistence, so by using more exactly point samples around the surface of our zeolite, and compute persistence diagrams in three dimensions, 0, 1, and 2 in this case, then we could detect 40% of all top-performing materials, so Pavel told me maybe up to 50% already, while a random sampling would output only 2%. So it is a huge improvement. And the idea is obviously not to try every hypothetical zeolite from this data set of 140,000 structures one by one, but use a training set of only 600. So molecular simulations running on a small subset of 600 is much faster, and this is enough to get a prediction. So now let me illustrate the output of the mapper algorithm, so from that paper on the whole data set. So every cluster here represents, every colored point represents a cluster of many hypothetical zeolites. The color corresponds to the heat of absorption, and you see what interesting cases in this corner, but generally the idea was to find different groups within this data set. As you see from the picture, they don't split, this is real data, so they don't split into well-separated groups, but nonetheless, looking at this mapper map, we could see that there are certainly different groups, and it will guide our search much better than, a random sampling or any other methods. Okay, if there are no questions so far, let me then go to our current research at the Materials Innovation Factory in Liverpool. So we are studying similar but slightly different so-called hydrogen organic frameworks. So hydrogen because molecules are held together by hydrogen bonds. So it is based on the recent paper Nature led by Professor Andy Cooper, who is the academic director at our Materials Innovation Factory. And the paper describes the data set of about 6,000 HOFs, hydrogen organic frameworks. And these are periodic structures consisting of the following molecules. So they call it T2. So it looks like a tripod, and it is considered as a rigid body in a three-dimensional space. Although when they synthesize, actually it might be a little bit bended. So this is a molecule, and every crystal structure then is represented by unit cell containing several such molecules. So this is structure number one from the dataset. It shows the non-rectangular cell and two T2 molecules inside. So to get the whole infinite structure, we do the following. We translate with a non-rectangular cell in three directions. So we generate a periodic structure in a three-dimensional space. Right, so that's our input. And since I have my laptop available, maybe I could show you how it works in Mercury. So this is again the same structure. Rotative. So see two tripods. Red balls are oxygen, gray balls are carbon, and blue balls are nitrogen atoms. White balls are hydrogen. So two molecules. And now let me show. Not this one. So that's the box. So the file describes the positions of atoms in this box, and also let me show if we stop animation a suitable moment. Let me show the hydrogen bonds. So these bonds are between molecules. So if I click If I click here, then you could see, well, another tripod molecule that is translated from this position. So this software Mercury can easily visualize what we see. However, well, it has its limitations. And go back to the slides. Okay, so the C file, crystallographic information file, describes for positions in a non-rectangular cell, well, which is translated, and that's how we get an infinite structure for our material. And also this file specifies for chemical bonds between atoms within a single molecule and between different molecules. Well, now the first mathematical question. So we have say two different infinite periodic graphs. Let's take one infinite periodic graph. For this one graph, we could generate different unit cells. So it could be like that. It could contain say two molecules. It could contain six. So where unit cell is not canonical at all. So it means that the same periodic structure will be represented by, well, different C files, so simply containing, well, different numbers of molecules. And the first question is to identify, well, geometric duplicates in this data set. So these are example of structures 2 and 3 in the data set. And I'm wondering if you could tell me whether they are identical or not, in your opinion. So they are represented by different files, but, well, the first question that we should answer, well, to speed up research, to speed up molecular simulations for predicting chemical properties, is to understand whether they are different or not. Your suggestion, your guess?
Yes.
Well, chemists agree with you. Well, actually, I didn't. So let me explain. So I have compared them geometrically, well, as few mathematicians do, up to rotations and translation in a three-dimensional space, and I realized that geometrically they are different. But chemists consider them as duplicates, as equivalent. So why? So Mercury can compare just two different structures, but trying, well, to match them. So this is a picture showing, well, the previous structures overlaid. So, and the difference between them, well, so one structure is shown with native colors, so blue, gray, red, white, etc. And the second structure is in green. And you see, they are indeed almost identical. But there is a difference between them. That's why, I have found this difference. So, the root mean square distance between atoms, well, after we try to match them, is about 0.17 angstroms, which might seem a small value. However, remember that, well, distances between inter-atom distances in a molecule are about 1-2 angstroms. So this is actually about 10%. So this is rather substantial error tolerance. When I first talked to chemists about TDA and about stability theorem that will allow us to apply resistance to noisy data, they told me, well, our data is not noisy at all, so we have exact positions of atoms, don't worry about noise. Well, as you see, it is quite large. Right, so what's the next? So let me, well, summarize, well, past methods that are used by material scientists to compare, well, different structures. So we have two infinite structures represented by C files, and then we choose a number of molecules to match. So the default value is 15. You could ask why, and I have recently read the paper that is the base of this algorithm for Mercury, and the paper justifies this number 15 as follows. Okay, we tried 15, we also tried 30, and results are almost similar. That's why we have chosen 15. So that's the whole justification. And there are also other parameters like a tolerance for distances between atoms. sort of there are many parameters here, and the output actually depends on on these parameters. So if, for example, I try, say 20% error tolerance on distances, then indeed the previous structures are considered identical. If you change the number of molecules, matched molecules, then the root mean square changes. For example, if you'd like to identify just 2 molecules, not 15, then the root mean square will be smaller. And at the moment, only pairwise comparisons are possible. However, remember that we have a large data set, so it's not practical to run pairwise comparisons for the whole data set. So essentially we need something else. We need a complete geometric invariant describing such a periodic structure of two rotations and translations in 3D. Yes, by using some tolerance, but it should be not by using, say, 15 molecules. So as mathematicians, we should be able to work with infinite periodic graphs. Why not? Okay, so our initial approach is the following. So we consider every T2 molecule as a solid body, as a rigid tripod, and its position in a three-dimensional space can be described by 6 parameters. So by its center with 3 coordinates, and also 3 angles determined by actual rotation, the actual position with a fixed center. So we have now a point in a three-dimensional space with 3 more angles attached, and then we represent every hydrogen bond as an abstract edge between these 2 centers. And you see they are different because one hydrogen bond goes from nitrogen to oxygen, so from one molecule to another one, and in the opposite way we could go from oxygen to nitrogen. So we have directed edges here highlighted in different colors, and this can be considered now as a combinatorial graph with extra geometric information associated to vertices and edges. So we compared these combinatorial graphs, and that's how we realized that structures number 2 and 3 are different, but this was only because our error tolerance was much smaller than we expected. So this is the ongoing work, and chemists were working on this data set for already 2 years, and they were of course very motivated to produce something interesting. So the idea was to find nanoporous structures based on hydrogen organic frameworks that can be stable, so have low energy and suitable for capturing methane. So computations were slow, that's why the whole project was all over 2 years, and the results look like that. So on the horizontal axis we have the density, so in this data set of 6,000 structures we have materials of various density. In the first diagram the vertical axis is the energy, and we are so-called lattice energy, and we are interested in structures with lowest possible energy. The color, in the first diagram, the color shows the type of pores. So the yellow color means this long pipes. So it's like one-dimensional type of a pore. And they have tried a few materials from this local minima, if you wish, in a non-strict sense. So they have identified 4 materials that are actually stable and synthesized them after that. This diagram shows gain versus density where the deliverable capacity for methane. See, this is red color is for high capacity and blue color is for lower capacity. So how do they look? It turned out the structures look are rather symmetric, but in a large data set it was hard to predict them. So these two are almost two-dimensional, but these 3 they're depicted in a planar way, but actually they are more complicated, so we have a essential three-dimensional structure. So we have already well predicted energy. We have simulations for methane capacity. We also have computed some other chemical properties. So we have a good data set now to try the topological method. So our next step after comparing structures geometrically and removing duplicates is to get a topological map, for example, based on the mapper algorithm, and see where are the structures in this map. And also, you see, this is a general approach. Every material is usually represented by a crystallographic information file, so it's periodic. You have a non-rectangular cell, so the whole idea can be extended to other datasets, and the largest, I think, is the Cambridge crystallographic database, consisting of almost 1 million structures at the moment, and it's growing fast. Okay, and in the last 10 minutes, let me switch to a slightly different topic, which is actually simpler. So before we have talked about materials, crystal structures in a three-dimensional space, and now it will be for two-dimensional data. So simpler, and that's why I hope to inspire colleagues and potential students with programming skills to join. So this is a joint project with Mark Ho, who is a chemical engineer from Glasgow, and he's working on colloidal suspensions. So we have colloidal particles, say, in water or in any other liquid, and the aim is to distinguish different so-called phases of these colloids. So there are let me maybe show the picture, it will be easier to see. So Mark designs simulations for these colloidal particles based on what interparticle energy between them. So he uses the standard energy when at small distances particles are repelled from each other, as natural, but there is a local maximum when then they actually are attracted to each other. So they, according to this model, they might form some clusters. And we are interested to distinguish different types of these clusters. So this is a rather technical description of this energy function that is used for simulation. And it contains several parameters, like the radius of particles, these distances delta A, delta R, when you have attraction, repulsion. And also the important parameter is the area fraction of particles. So how dense are they? On the next slide, this one will show different patterns. So how is it working? So any mathematician could actually design this computation, so that's why I explained that it is not too complicated at all. So you have, 1,000 particles in a unit square, and then, they are not overlapping round disks. And then we try to perturb each particle. So it's very similar to Monte Carlo simulations. We generate a random move for every particle, and then compute the new energy, which is the sum of all pairwise interparticle potentials. So if the new energy is smaller, so if the whole system goes closer to an optimum, then we accept this move with this probability, so which should be less than one, and then repeat. So we accept a move only if the energy goes down and the new positions of particles produce a non-overlapping configuration for all of them, and then repeat. So we repeat a lot of time steps, but after 10 million time steps, we can get different configurations. So the simulation has a few important parameters, and one of them is the area fraction. So for different values of the density, well, the final output of the simulation may look like what? And humans would certainly distinguish, well, that, well, this is more chaotic, this is more organized, and here we have long chains and labyrinths, so we certainly distinguish them somehow. And the problem was, well, to design an automatic tool to, well, to distinguish them, for example, by using persistence. So this is, well, the actual computation of the one-dimensional persistence diagrams for, well, these three point clouds. So this one looks well, a bit chaotic, and this has long chains, and this is this contains more well, dense clusters. And indeed, well, we are not able to compare them directly, so we cannot simply subtract well, this point cloud from that point cloud, right? But the persistence diagrams show the difference. So this is, well, a typical shape for some, well, noisy sample, say from the unit square. But this one has dots near, well, near some curve, near the diagonal here. And the next pattern with more dense clusters has the same curves, so more dots near that curve, and also more dots along that vertical line. And, well, you could guess, well, there is a simple explanation for these dots, since we have, well, many clusters looking like that, so we have many small holes formed by, well, three particles forming a triangle. That's why holes are born roughly at the same moment here, and then they, well, die, well, later. So, but, and indeed, I have, yes, a question.
So, what are the yellow bars on the diagrams and the green triangle?
So, these are not very important for the particular simulation, but I could explain that they show the widest diagonal gap in the persistence diagram. So I simply ran, well, my standard implementation outputting the one-dimensional persistence diagrams, highlighting the widest diagonal gap, so most persistent features. But this actually not relevant here, so we are not looking for most persistent cycles, so we simply would like to compare different persistence diagrams. And indeed, I think here it's convenient to mention the related work by Yasuo Hiraoka, Vanessa Robbins, and co-authors recently published about configurations of granular bits. So this paper, you see, outputs two-dimensional persistence diagrams with rather similar curves near the diagonal. However, it is for three-dimensional data, so we can see the, well, round balls in a three-dimensional space, and the diagrams are computed for the two-dimensional persistence, so it's even more complicated. So that's why I hope that a similar analysis for the two-dimensional data should be certainly possible. And the only, well, obstacle at the moment is, well, is a lack of students with programming skills. So if anyone is interested, this project is simply waiting for you. Okay. So instead of finishing with a technical summary, let me finish, well, with the illustration of the whole idea of our materials innovation factory, where we would like to combine, well, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science with the experiments. So briefly as follows. So we have a prediction program, for example, using, well, topological methods to get top performing structures that could be synthesized now not by humans but by robots. So this is indeed a factory where robots will synthesize materials and then test their properties experimentally. So it will be working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Yes, no holidays for Christmas. So we would like to design a closed assembly line, when the results of, well, these robotic experiments are passed back to the prediction program, which could guide our further search. So this is a closed assembly line. So Materials Innovation Factory, well, is just opening, so it will be officially opened actually later this year. And if anyone is interested in applying topological methods to material science, there will be certainly opportunities at Liverpool, so I encourage you to keep in touch. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes?
So as far as I understand, there are two different aspects of what do you call a promising material model. One is that how easy is to synthesize in the real life, and the other is how promising the properties are. Mm-hmm. So in which aspect is the topological data analysis more effective?
Well, so we should use for both. We should try to apply topology to both properties. So my current work was focusing first on geometry, actually not on topology yet, but maybe Pavel could comment what was more efficient. So we could actually combine both. So we need a filter function, right, on our data set, and this filter function, yes, it could be the energy, it could be the methane capacity. The brief answer, we don't know yet, so your contribution would be highly appreciated.
Other questions?
In this colored picture, you have shown some persistence diagram for these three different stages, three different types of colors.
Mm-hmm.
But typically, these people that study these type of materials, they plan to do statistics. So how do you plan to address that with the persistence diagram?
Yeah, this is a good, very good question. So we have, well, persistence landscapes that summarize persistence diagrams in the form of a piecewise linear function. And, well, the shape of this persistence landscape could be passed to a machine learning algorithm, for example. Yes, we haven't done it yet, but if you have, skills and time, you're very welcome.
Other questions? Okay, I guess it's time for lunch then, and then we meet again at 3 this afternoon.